Ladies and gentlemen, every single time we meet, we start with a prayer for the state of Israel. Avinu shebashamayim, Tzur Yisrael v'goalo, barech et medinat Yisrael, rashit tzmichat geulatenu, הגן עליה בעברת חסדך, ופרוס עליה סוכת שלומך. ושלח אורך ועמיתך לראשיה, שריה ויועציה, ותקנם בעיצה טובה מלפניך. חזק את ידי מגיני ארץ קודשנו, והנחילם אלוהינו ישועה, ועטרת ניצחון תאתרם. ונתת שלום בארץ, ושמחת עולם ליושביה, ונאמר אמן. And so once again we have a bit of our history, because we're looking at Parashat Emor, but we're also looking at the period in which there was a lot of controversy. It's not unique right now that, you know, Jewish people don't agree. I'm going to point out another time, and it eventually was resolved. Sometimes not peacefully, but resolved. But let me start, and I'm wondering if all of you know who coined the phrase al magash ha kesef, on the silver platter. Who started with that idea? Well, in Atlantic City, Dr. Chaim Weizmann is speaking to the audience, and he says it was actually, yes, Atlantic City, UJA, and he's telling them to all of them that a state is not given to a nation on a silver platter. About a week later, a very famous and wonderful poet, Nathan Alterman, writes this silver platter poem, which is used over and over again because, unfortunately, sometimes, what is a silver platter? That everything is really given to you nicely, right? Here's the poem. I'll read it in English so that we all understand. Nathan Alterman writes, and the land is quiet. The red hue of the sky dims slowly over smoldering frontiers. And a nation stands torn hearted, but breathing to receive a miracle unlike any other. And she readies herself. She is a nation, by the way, right? She readies herself for the ceremony. She rises facing the moon, stands before the dawn, draped in celebration and awe. And then from afar, there come forth a girl and a boy. And slowly they walk towards the nation. The nation is personified, right? Dressed for work and for war and heavily shod, to the path walking in silence. They haven't changed clothes nor washed away the traces of days of toil and nights under fire. Infinitely weary, hermits from repose and gleaming with the dew of Hebrew youth, they approach in silence and stand motionless, and there's no way of knowing, bless you, whether they're alive or have been shot. And then the nation, in tears and wonder, asks, who are you? And the two quietly answer, we are the silver platter upon which the Jewish state is handed to you. Thus they say, and they fall at her feet, wrapped in shadow, and the rest will be told in the annals of the history of Israel. They are the silver platter. Pardon? Alterman, Nathan Alterman, A-L-T-E-R. Nathan Alterman, a state is not given on a silver platter. And in the spirit of the 75th birthday of the State of Israel, we will examine another great controversy and wonderful miracle. I'm going to start, though, today with Parashat Emor, just to tell you that there are seven different doubles. In other words, sometimes we are forced to combine two parshiot, and the reason is simply the calendar. Parashat Emor is all about the calendar. If there aren't enough Shabbatot, enough Saturdays, to go through each parasha by itself, then we are often forced to combine the parshiot. And I'll tell you the ones that are, only these are combined, others are not. And we've gone through a couple. Last week we did a Haremot, that is yesterday. So which ones are they? Vayakel Pekudei, Tazria Metzora, you'll see that it's mostly the book of Leviticus. Acharei Mot Kedoshim, which we did yesterday, we will be doing Behar B'chukotai. This coming Shabbat, there's only one parasha, Parashat Emor. And the other two are Matot Masei and Nitzavim Vayelech. Because we have only a certain number of Shabbatot, it's not a leap year. And therefore, we don't have the extra month, which would give us four extra Saturdays. And the rule is that we must start the book of Numbers always before Shavuot. So we get to be, I guess, in a little bit of a hurry because we're not skipping parshiot. What is sometimes skipped is the Haftarah in favor of another Haftarah. But the parshiot go in order. And so in the book of Leviticus, it often happens that we need to somehow contract and take two at a time instead of only one. Bamidbar, that is starting the book of Numbers, must always come before Shavuot. Shavuot, by the way, is exactly after Victoria Day weekend. And so what we understand is that Parashat Emor is all about the calendar. Calendar is given to us as Jews as the very first mitzvah. The reason is that free people control their own time. They are masters of their own time. And today we are looking at the mitzvah that is in this parasha for counting. What are we counting? The Omer. How many? Pardon?
Blessings.
We're counting blessings. We're counting the Omer. Exactly. And so if you're looking at your Eitz Chaim, I'll tell you where we're looking in Parashat Emor. Let's start on page 726. 726 is where we have the counting of the Omer. 726. You know what? There are many more than two approaches to the Omer. Some people, you know, as you say. So we are looking at the counting of the Omer. Do you not have a Chumash? Okay. The counting of the Omer in the Torah is not a time of mourning. I need to stress that. We are going to read it. It is not a time of mourning. The time of mourning during the counting of the Omer starts in the year 135 of the Common Era, the time of Rabbi Akiva and Bar Kokhba. So we'll talk about that very briefly, but counting in the Torah is definitely not a time of mourning. In fact, it's a time of anticipation. We anticipate that after Passover, we will come, how many days? To Shavuot, how many days? 49, which equals 7 weeks. So number seven is always magical. We are not going to say a bracha because the counting takes place in the evening, right? In the evening, we count for the day. Everything starts in the evening. But for us, we need to know that Saturday evening, that is last night, we counted Hayom Arba'a V'Esrim Yom Shehem Shlosha Shavuot U'Shlosha Yamim La'Omer. That is, it's already 3 weeks and 3 days. 24. Sorry, but he has his hand up. Go ahead.
It says we cannot properly enjoy it until we have thanked God for it. So I think our people are quite unique in that, like other nations, we thank Hashem We thank God for what we're about to do.
Yes.
But we might be unique in also thanking God after we've eaten.
Yes, because the chances are that when people are full and they're satiated, nope, that's it. Come on, right? Often they need a little break, a little bit of a sleep and so on. You're absolutely right. So we acknowledge that hamotzi lechem min ha'aretz, right? And we say bracha to make us more aware and sensitive, especially in what I started today with this tower culture, as opposed to being close to nature, close to the land, where children and adults see everything growing. So it's not like, you know, when I need bread, I don't exactly grow the wheat, right? I usually go to some fine bakery. Not always. Spirat HaOmer, the counting of the Omer, therefore, is a mitzvah. Remember that we have, how many mitzvot, positive mitzvot do we have?
What?
248. And negative? 365. For a total of 613. This is a positive mitzvah. It says, you shall count. Usfartem lachem mimacharat haShabbat. And this is where we trip. We're tripping already because Maharat HaShabbat, what does that mean? And we'll discuss that. Go ahead. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So we're saying, you know, it's, and that's usually given as an example, like a child says, you know, in 5 days, I'll have my birthday. Do you know what I'll have in 5 days? My birthday, right? And so you get sort of very, very excited. Mimacharat HaShabbat is the problem. And so Rabbi Sacks will touch on that in his wonderful, wonderful book, saying that we sometimes have things that are ambiguous in the Torah. They're ambiguous, meaning that they need interpretation. And if you should have the book at home, and you may, this is the book on Leviticus. You'll see it. I'll tell you the page if you're referring to it. Ambiguity. We've talked about that before, that sometimes it's not specific so that there's no controversy. One more time. Did I say controversy? Who was not agreeing? Why didn't they agree? It says me macharat haShabbat. Well, it's ambiguous. It was accentuated, it says, by deep schisms, breaks, disagreement. That's why we have such a beautiful word in Hebrew, machloket. What's machloket? This side, right? This side says A and the other side, no way, it's B, right? Machloket means chelek, half or whatever. They say A, but no. Machloket means a division of opinion. It's an argument. So who was arguing? And let me tell you why it's interesting. In those, well, many, many times we've had Judaism that is divided. At one point, we had the Sadducees and we had the Pharisees. And we, of course, have the Karaites. We have all kinds of labels. Ideally, we don't label, but there are labels. Sadducees are people who were generally very close to the temple. And their idea was that we need to take it literally. Mimacharat haShabbat literally means the day after Shabbat. Therefore, it must be Sunday. That's one opinion. The Pharisees, of course, said no, that's not the way it works. Pharisees believed in interpretation. Pharisees are people who are rabbinic Jews, and the Pharisees believe that the Torah is given to us, but we as human beings interpret. Do we do that today? Absolutely. Are we rabbinic Jews? Yes. So the Karaites, the Sadducees, various sects used to understand everything literally. I've given that example before. I'll just say it one more time. If it says you should not burn any fire on Shabbat, they sat in the dark. The rabbinic people said, no, we can burn the fire before Shabbat. We don't need to sit in the dark. It can, in other words, we light candles before Shabbat. And that's just one example of what it means to be a literalist.
They're having a problem. We can't see her.
Oh, it doesn't matter. You just have to hear me. I look the same today.
I'm so sorry. I didn't know that. I'm so sorry. Oh, dear.
I can't see me either, so it's okay.
Oh, dear.
So what's the issue? Let me just make sure you understand the issue. If there's a disagreement, does that mean that we can have two different calendars? Can we divide our people and have two different calendars? Some people will then count 50 days, 49 days until another Sunday, but other people will count it starting from the day after Pesach, after the first day of Pesach. And therefore, it will always be on the Shavuot, will always be on the sixth day of Sivan. I want all of us to understand how important this is. Because we as a people cannot be fragmented. And although we have been many, many times, and sometimes it's not a joke, I'm giving another example today, okay? If, on the other hand, you are looking for some definitive authority, it seems to be that the Greek translation of the Bible, which is going back to the 3rd century before the Common Era, supports the idea that we start counting on the second night of Pesach. And Josephus, who's a great historian, also supports it. In other words, this is going way, way back. We cannot afford to have splintered Judaism. Today you celebrate Shavuot and tomorrow he celebrates Shavuot and there's a different calendar. That is a danger to the unity of the Jewish people. So for all of us, we know that Shavuot is on the sixth day of Sivan. How are we doing? That is, well, that's why I was worried about not bringing your equipment. Go ahead.
Why is it that, I mean, like on the 33rd day, it's like going back, why is it that some people still go to add 17 more days and make it 50? Why is some Jewish people?
Well, we're going to read the source. In other words, when we read the Torah, we know that the Torah dictates, says a mitzvah, that we are to count. How many days do we count? We are counting 49 days in order to get from one holiday to the next, meaning that there's a bridge between Pesach and Shavuot. Right.
Some people, after 33 days, they go, they can resume.
I can't vouch for some people. I can only say what.
Yeah.
In other words, what you're referring to probably is the fact that some people don't want to continue the mourning period for that long, because the 33rd day in our calendar was a time when the decree of not burying the Jewish soldiers was lifted and people could bury their dead. Rabbi Sacks is saying that there is the ambiguity was accentuated by deep schisms in Jewish life in the late Second Temple period between the Pharisees and other groups like the Sadducees and the Samaritans. Where did the Samaritans live? On Shomon, up north, exactly. And the Qumran. Who are the Qumranites? The people who live near the Dead Sea Scroll. If you're referring to it at home, it is page 338. So the Karaites get their name by virtue of, Karaites mean they read Likro. Karaites mean that they read it and therefore they are literalists. The Sadducees refused to accept the oral law that was developing at that time. During the Second Temple. That doesn't mean that the oral law didn't exist, but it was developing more and more because the Tanaim are the Mishnah Chachamim, the sages of the Mishnah. the Tanaim were bringing, and one of the big Tanaim that we know, you all know Tanaim, all of you. One of them is Hillel, and the other one is Shammai, and the other one is the one we're going to talk about is Rabbi Akiva. We honor Rabbi Akiva. What is the miracle of Rabbi Akiva?
He didn't know how to read.
Exactly. He didn't know. I'm going to tell you what I think is the miracle of Rabbi Akiva. Miracle of Rabbi Akiva is he had the loveliest wife. Correct. His wife encouraged him. His wife said, I'll marry you if you promise that you'll go, because I see the potential, and if you'll go and learn, I'll marry you. Her father was very much against it. So Rabbi Akiva's miracle is, number one, that he found the right woman. Number two, I didn't say other people didn't, but Rabbi Akiva did. Number two, Rabbi Akiva actually comes from a family of converts. And his learning, his scholarship, and his position as the authority that he became shows us that Judaism became more democratic. For a long time, the leaders were Kohanim. How do you become a Kohen? Only if your father's a Kohen, right? But a scholar, the crown of learning, can come to anyone who works hard and acquires that position. So Rabbi Akiva, at the age of 40, undertakes to start learning Aleph, Bet, and whatever, and he does become the great scholar. So it's enormously, enormously empowering. Remember, these are rabbinic Jews. But what is sad and difficult for us to accept is that at one point, Rabbi Akiva made a decision that no, we cannot tolerate what the Romans are doing. He would say, Ki hem chayenu be'orach yameinu, if we're not allowed to learn Torah, if we cannot maintain Judaism, we will disappear. And therefore, he defied them and taught Torah and learned Torah and paid a very heavy price because he was caught and died a terrible death. What we're saying is, Rabbi Akiva made a decision. Remember, there's no king in those days. Who are the leaders? The leaders are the rabbis and the prophets, but there are no prophets in 135 of the Common Era. It's already after the Second Temple. So Rabbi Akiva at that point makes the decision that yes, we're going to fight against who? Against the mighty Roman Empire. And that he believed so strongly this war on the Jewish side was going to be led by a man called Bar Kokhba. He called him actually the son of a star. Kochav is a star. Believed that this was an important war. We know that wars are devastating. And should anyone come along and say, we, right, little Palestine is going to fight against the Roman Empire, what would you say?
You're not a singer.
You'd say, please think about it. If you don't have to, don't, because the war is devastating. You can't do that. And so that's what happened. Rabbi Akiva paid the price. Many people paid the price. We think the tradition is that he had 24,000 students. I'm not sure how. His boardroom was way bigger. Yes. Yes. Correct. Very sad. I think very sad.
Can you repeat the question, please, or the comment?
The question has to do with Rabbi Akiva, whose students are reputed to have been very fine students, except that they didn't learn to get along so well with one another. And we're actually, I always feel terrible about that, because if that's not what he taught, then he missed a very important mitzvah of mitzvot bein adam lachavero, mitzvot that are between people, right? Giving each other the respect and the dignity. And so the ambiguity says, ambiguity, says Rabbi Sacks, was accentuated by the fact that we had so many different, what I would even call tribalism, right? Some people are of the tribe of the Sadducees and the Pharisees and the Qumran, the people who left and they're living near the Dead Sea because they don't like what's going on in Yerushalayim anyways. And so later on, of course, there are others, the Karaites. The Karaites come about 1,000 of the Common Era. And so here is what he writes, that the Sadducees and the Karaites understood the phrase, what we're going to look at in the Torah, as the day after Passover. And so the controversy here is, what is Mimacharat HaShabbat? When you're reading the bottom of page 726, look with me. The sages, line number 3, the sages held at the very, very bottom. The sages held that the Sabbath here refers to the Pesach festival, explaining that interpretation, Arama writes, if the Omer were tied to Shabbat, the symbol of the creation of the world, then the wheat harvest would be seen purely as a natural phenomenon. Connecting it to the Exodus teaches us to see it, like the Exodus, as an instance of God's benevolence. It's another way of understanding how we, because the Omer is also a sacrifice. What it is saying at the end of the day is, and this is the message I get, there can be only one approach. Ultimately, you may not agree, but there's going to be only one halakha, or one calendar, or one understanding of when we start counting. Today, we don't have a problem because all of us are Pharisees or rabbinic Jews, and we all start counting here in the diaspora on the second Seder. In Israel, obviously, on the second night. I'm looking at verse number 15. Let's read it. And this is what we say every night. From the day on which you bring the sheaf of elevation, the day after the Sabbath, what's going to be interpreted? The Sabbath. You shall count off 7 weeks. They must be complete, and you must count until the day after the 7th week, 50 days. And then you shall bring an offering of new grain to the Lord. That is the 50th day, then, is Shavuot, right? When we bring the new grain. Shavuot is another harvest holiday. Remember, we have 3 harvest holidays. They're all the pilgrimage holidays. Pesach is a harvest holiday in Israel. Shavuot is a harvest holiday. It's really summertime. And Sukkot is a harvest holiday. They were all agricultural holidays when people were living on the land and growing stuff, right? And so that's the problem here. There's going to be a discussion, and it won't always be friendly. I didn't tell you anything you didn't know, right? Sometimes it's not friendly because it's my way or the highway, right? The Israelites eventually in the land of Israel came to the conclusion that it's going to be the authority of rabbis, because just to remind you, do we have Sadducees today? No. The Sadducees eventually disappeared when the temple disappeared, because the Sadducees were people who worked in the temple, and they were connected to the upper class. Those are the Sadducees. Today we have Pharisees. We have many other divisions. There's no discussion. We're good at dividing, but we're also good at uniting. Rabbi Sacks also tells us that he's talking a lot about the number 7. He loves to do that. And so he says in Parashat Emor, we have 7 holidays. And so he really focuses on that. Let's look at 2 more things that in the Parashah, because I'm hoping to do I'm always hoping. I don't lack any. Yes. Right. And so this is the mitzvah of counting. Did you really, really get the difference between the biblical mitzvah and what we do today? Biblical mitzvah was not about mourning, not at all. What we do today is to remember the fight that Jewish people had, and it was really a war for religious freedom. We had a few of those already, right? The time of the Maccabees, we fought for religious freedom. The time of the Romans, we fought for our own way of life. Not easy. In our parasha, there is another couple of things that I really want to focus on. Number one is on 7:27, and I'm looking at verse 22. When there's a harvest, k'tzir artzechem means you are cutting your harvest. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap all the way to the edges of your field. That's assuming you have a field, right? Are you allowed to take everything? No. You have to leave some. You're not allowed to gather the gleanings of your harvest. Sometimes things fall. Sometimes you shall leave them for the poor and the stranger. And it ends with the words, I am the Lord. So it says, in the time of harvest, what must you keep in mind? You are lucky. You have a field and you have crops. You have harvested so much and you will have food. But the poor should be permitted to come in and glean from your field, especially the corners that are going to be kept for them. And there's going to be a certain amount of dignity. They are permitted and allowed. Where do we see that very clearly? In the book of Ruth, with Boaz and Ruth. Ruth is told, stay in this field. Come and follow my harvesters, glean and take some food. He recognized that she was feeding herself and her mother-in-law. And she was the support, right? She was there to support her mother-in-law. And she had acquired a good reputation. So strangers, orphans, widows, poor people, they're all the people who are coming in to the field. And the book of Ruth tells you, don't let anyone molest you, because sometimes, you know, the poor people wouldn't be treated with kid gloves. Come and glean. So the mitzvah is another positive mitzvah. Poor people must be supported. And this is one of them. They don't need to put out their hand. They can come into the field and glean. The other two mitzvot that I really want to focus on is the fact that the Torah says we need to be very sensitive. We're going back to 7:23. How do we acquire that sensitivity for life? For, in this case, about animals. We have a mitzvah in the Torah that says, Tsa'ar Ba'alei Chaim. What is that mitzvah? Tsa'ar Ba'alei Chaim. Tsa'ar means the pain of creatures, exactly, living things. And Maimonides will tell you, and you're looking at 7:23, under the line at the bottom, Maimonides writes, there is no distinction between the suffering of a human being and that of a beast, because the feelings of maternal affections belong not to the intellectual faculty. The animal has feelings of pain. But to the emotional faculty, which is common to humans and animals alike. And therefore, what does the mitzvah say? In verse number 26, it says, the Lord spoke to Moses saying, when an ox or a sheep or a goat is born, it shall stay 7 days with its mother. And from the 8th day on, it shall be acceptable as a gift to the Lord. A gift meaning that it is given as an offering. However, no animal from the herd or from the flock shall be slaughtered on the same day with its young. Don't forget that what it's doing to us as people, not only to the animals, to be very, very considerate and to be sensitive.
So how would you consider explaining to our course as number one, and what we're not informed of the servant duty for most of us is that the goats on the bus service.
Yeah, but we're not going to touch the goat. The
goat was not sent into the wilderness. The goat, as I learned this Shabbat, was thrown off the cliff and rolled down and was dismembered as it rolls out. If that's not cruelty to animals, Corinne shouldn't be listening to this, I don't know what is. And it says here, don't be cruel to animals. So how would our sages explain those two incidents?
Exactly right. I started with the understanding that there is some ambiguity. That whole thing about the goat, Seir Lazazel, is a huge problem. And I'm not able to actually analyze that. It is a huge problem. And the kapara idea that we use today, the kapara meaning on before Yom Kippur, some people do that. And let me tell you what they do. They go down to Kensington or Chabad, and they buy a chicken and they swing the chicken. Exactly. Swing the chicken. That is the chicken that is now going to take over my sins. Although my sins are going into that chicken, it will be slaughtered, but it will be given to the poor people. Or if you're not exactly excited about swinging the chicken, you can just take 18 cents, $18, 18 something, swing it and say Zot Kaparati and so on. Because again, remember, the people were closer to nature. And there was maybe a lot of chickens, I don't know, running around, a lot of chickens. And we live in a city, so we are quite repelled by the idea. We're not even sure what the chicken will do up here. So, but the fact is that Chabad will come in with a truck full of chickens and Erev Yom Kippur, and you can buy that chicken and the chicken will be donated. But I'd like to be able to find some logic with the...
custom and superstition common sense and halacha was written.
How do they just tell on the city to allow you still to have hens in your backyard?
Yeah.
Can you still have hens in the backyard? Yes. I remember a neighbor in Bathurst Manor had a goat. A goat. Now, this wasn't the goat that was going to be thrown down anywhere. That's true.
Hannah?
Yes.
Are people still even allowed to do kaparas with a chicken?
Is that against the
law?
The chicken is basically going to be slaughtered properly and then donated to poor people. As far as I know, yes. I could be corrected.
But I thought you just said that Chabad is going around so that people would...
I know somebody who went and did
that. Are people still swinging the chicken around? It sounds like laws of animal cruelty are being...
I think your question is important. I didn't see it with my own eyes, but I have very good evidence that this was done. It may be done with the idea that this is a way to have the kapara and give tzedakah at the same time. Okay. Yes.
Everything is permitted except this is forbidden.
Rambam, he was a master of words. Just read the guide for the perplexed and you'll see how perplexed you'll be.
Is it fair that poor people have to eat the chicken that has all your sins?
I'm not sure how my sins have been transferred to that poor chicken, but I hear you. And in the Parashat Emor also, and you know very well that if Chas v'Chalila we go, and it happens a lot, we go to a funeral, where are the Kohanim? They're not inside, right? Unless, and we're looking at page 717, where it says that the Kohanim are to keep away. By the way, why is there such a strong injunction against death? Remember that people are coming from Egypt. In Egypt, death is very important, right? You build pyramids, right? And in the pyramid, you put some stuff in case the dead people need it.
I also heard sometimes a wife and a widow can be put in there too.
Exactly. Judaism is saying we are a religion that celebrates life, the chai bahem. We celebrate life, and the mitzvot are to live, to help us live. And that's why even Shabbat is pushed aside if it's a matter of life and death. Exactly. So at the very top of Parashat Emor, it says, speak to the priest, the son of Aharon, and say to them, none shall defile himself for any dead. Now, that means that a Kohen is not allowed to go for close to any dead body, except, okay, people in the immediate family, except for the relatives that are closest to him. It says specifically his mother, his father, his son or his daughter, and his brother. Also for a virgin sister, she's not married yet. Close to him, because she has not married, for her he may defile himself. Defile is a strong word, but it means you have been near the body of a dead person, and that means that the Kohen cannot go and serve in the temple until he does whatever he needs to do. So he may defile himself, but he shall not defile himself as a kinsman by marriage. So in other words, if it's a sister-in-law, that's a different thing. So there's all about Torah Kohanim, and Leviticus is a book that focuses on the Kohanim and what they are or are not allowed to do. There's an awful lot more. And the part that is controversial that we're not going to discuss, because in those days, it was clear that an animal that has any kind of blemish cannot be brought as a sacrifice. Because, you know, you're not going to be looking just, well, I don't need this one anyways. It has a blemish. That law also applies to the Kohanim. Remember, people didn't have the same understanding that we have today, right, of various handicaps, and the Kohen who has a problem with some handicap will not be serving. He will not be serving. So is there more? There's a lot more, but I want to also tell you that I've prepared a few things about Chilul Hashem, Kiddush Hashem, and another miraculous period in our history. Very often we connect to our calendar, right? And still in the spirit of the 75th birthday of the State of Israel, I must tell you, and it's not so simple, there was huge fights and controversies about Hebrew. Why? Why? Doesn't it make sense to you that everybody should be very glad that Hebrew is a spiritual way to unite all the people, that we get that sense that we're together, that we are Am Echad? Why should there be so much pain about accepting it? And I've brought a couple of books that I think are very, very interesting, because Eliezer Perlman, you know him, right? Well, if you've gone on the street called Ben Yehuda once or twice, that's Eliezer Perlman. That he grew up in, and he went to yeshiva. He was quite the young man. Well, he was also in jail. Did you want to know that too? It's all about the controversy. And I think it's fascinating because, you know, at the end of the day, we come out on top, but not without a little aggravation, right? And a little bit of despair. Why was he imprisoned? And what did he actually accomplish? Let's start with number one. When was the word Zionism coined?
1897.
You're close. It's before Theodore Herzl, but you're very close, and that's very good.
Jabotinsky.
Jabotinsky? No, Jabotinsky's after.
I thought it was a Zionist Congress.
No, it's before the Zionist Congress. And let me tell you that, let me just tell you, when was Zionism a word that was coined? 1885. You were close. And the man that coined the word Zionism is called Nathan Birnbaum. He was a Viennese. Nathan Birnbaum says that he's talking about Zionism. In fact, he says, is the best path to security instead of what people believed was a good way is assimilation. He advocated for Zionism. You know that Theodor Herzl comes afterwards. Who comes before 1885 advocating that we must all be in Israel and make Hebrew a living language? Yosef, no, I'm sorry, Bialik is afterwards. It's his name is Pelman. Pelman, who is Pelman? Eliezer ben Yehuda. We all, if we go to Tel Aviv or we go to Yerushalayim, do we go on Ben Yehuda Street?
Yes.
Absolutely. 1885, the word Zionism comes into our language. But even before that, Eliezer ben Yehuda coins many, many words because there aren't enough words in the Hebrew language to make it an everyday language that you can use on the street. He suffers plenty for that, by the way. You know that. They don't like it at all. But a Hebrew-speaking high school is also built, and the name of it is, later on, Herzliya, because of Theodor Herzl. And Jewish people at that time spoke, and you probably remember some of it, they spoke Yiddish, they spoke Russian, they spoke Polish and Romanian, right? And German. And what do we know about German? It's hard. And also, why didn't they want to speak Hebrew? Well, let me tell you that. Exactly. So, right, number one, it's holy, and therefore the ultra-Orthodox said absolutely not. And who else said no? You know, in those days, the Reform movement is becoming a strong movement. And the Reform movement says, who needs it? We have German. I mean, Hebrew is very good for the Siddur. It's very good for the Bible. But we are Reformed Jews, and we don't need it. It says here that this person who's writing says, my mother and her schoolmates used to go around Tel Aviv urging everyone to speak Hebrew. Now, what about Eliezer Perlman? He's an Orthodox Jew to begin with. He's gone to yeshiva. He's got a good understanding. But he reads a book. What book did he read that was, I think you don't know because I didn't know either. He read the book about Robinson Crusoe. He read a book about Robinson Crusoe. And this is in Tsarist Russia. Eliezer Perlman is Lithuanian. He's an Orthodox Jew. And he read a Hebrew translation of this Daniel Defoe's classic of island survival. And he became convinced that this language of prayer should become a secular spoken modern language because it's going to unify all the people who come to Palestine. It's a spiritual unification. And therefore, after sailing into Jaffa in 1881 is way before Theodor Herzl. And he's the one who says we must all come to Israel. 1881, he's not even waiting for the terrible pogroms that happened where? In Russia and Poland, exactly. He took his wife. He says, you know, we're only going to speak Hebrew. He fanatically devoted his life to this idea. He was a fanatic, and we need somebody who's fanatically, you know, convinced that that's the only way to be. And then it says that one more thing. Why? Have you thought about it? Why is it that we don't speak our Hebrew like the Europeans? Do we speak like the Europeans? Right. So we are not doing the Ashkenazi pronunciation. We're doing the? Exactly. Let me tell you what it says, and I think very interesting. The book that I'm using, should you want to know, is called The Israelis, and it's very, very interesting. So Ben Yehuda believed, he changed his name too, right? He changed his name to Ben Yehuda, making it a Hebrew name, not Pelman. He believed that the Hebrew of Jerusalem's Sephardi community had an authentic sound, closer to the biblical tongue than the Ashkenazi. And of course, many Ashkenazi immigrants opposed him. It's just the beginning of the opposition, right? Not at all to be, you know, charging that the Sephardi dialect sounded strange to them anyways, not Western. So Ben Yehuda persisted because he also felt that if all Jews adopted the Sephardi dialect, Sephardi Mizrahi Jews would be brought closer to the increasingly powerful Ashkenazi establishment. Incredibly insightful. He recognized that the Ashkenazi Jews were getting more power, and they are. And he felt that the Sephardi Jews needed to have a good, strong sense of being part of our kibbutz galuyot, everybody coming in. So he said it helps to unify the different Jewish tribes. And so I do need to finish. He also felt that adopting one Sephardi accent would lessen the linguistic differences and rivalries among the Ashkenazi Jews. Can you just picture what's going on here? It's exactly like you said, you said, speak Yiddish. Do you speak Yiddish like a Litvak? Do you speak it like a Polish? Do you speak, how do you speak Yiddish? Like this one or like that, right? What he's saying is there's plenty of divisions among the Ashkenazi Jews. Let's bring in the Sephardi pronunciation. It's authentic. It will also make the Sephardi people feel more comfortable. How do we speak? We say Shabbat. Do we say Shabbos? Sometimes. So he says, now remember that this is not a man who has training in linguistics. He actually studied medicine, but then he became sick and he studied medicine. So he says it would lessen the linguistic differences and the rivalries. So you can always see already how friendly everybody is that they had in Europe. So then it says something that we're not surprised about. Jewish people fought bitter battles over Hebrew, of course. When the Technion, where's the Technion? In Haifa. The Technion, it is a wonderful technical college, opened up. Do you know when it opened up? Did we have a state at that time? 1913, even before the Hebrew University opened up in 1925. Yes. The Technion opens up in Haifa in 1913 with German as the official language. Because German, remember, was the language of intellectuals, right? Who spoke German? It's a very, it was a, exactly a lot. So it took a violent student faculty strike to get the administration to adopt Hebrew. Hebrew was a potent weapon in shaping an Israeli national identity. To me, by the way, it's so self-evident because that I grew up speaking Hebrew, right? But it wasn't all that simple in those days because the Reform were against, that was in Europe. The ultra-Orthodox, I was told by a tour guide, spit at his house. How dare he think that you can play ball or, you know, take out the garbage in Hebrew? What a terrible thing to do. So it was important for national identity. Zionism's central idea is that Jews are one people, exiles who should return to their land and shed their diaspora minority mentality, and ethnic divisions to create a new Jewish society with a modern Jewish culture and language. Hebrew was and is, says this book, the glue that binds together modern Israel. So in Israel, there are two official languages. They are and Arabic. Go ahead.
The original Kaddish prayer was Sephardic. The original Kaddish that we recite was in Sephardic. And we didn't make the Ashkenazi. The Sephardic still told to it, and the Ashkenazi has stuck that much.
That's right.
Even the Kaddish prayer was Sephardic.
Yeah. So, by the way, if you really want to think about it, Robinson Crusoe did a wonderful thing for he read about Robinson Crusoe and he said, oh, wow. Now, what does it mean to us? It means that there was a literature in Hebrew at that time. There were newspapers, but who were the people who were reading all of that? The well-educated. They are the people who could read a Hebrew newspaper. What he's saying is it's not only for well-educated. It has to be for all the people, that Hebrew is going to be the language of the nation that is coming in with German and Russian and Poland, that Polish and Spanish and whatever. Everybody's coming in and we'll have one language. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's correct. That is correct. What about jail? Did you want to know why he ended up in jail?
Sure.
Yes, let's find out. At one time, Ben Yehuda was imprisoned. Why? Again, just understand that, you know, we are very caring people. We care for each other, but he was imprisoned for allegedly having written an editorial in his newspaper calling for a revolt against the authorities. Who ruled Israel at that time?
Turkey.
The Turkish, the Ottoman, exactly. And so, supposedly, he wrote something about an uprising. I'm sure that's not true because that wasn't his focus. His focus was the language, right? He became a linguistic genius because he took a root from the Bible, used that root to create new words. So why do we have a word for computer? We take the root word for to think or to compute or to count, and we create a word called computer. We can have all kinds of, and that's how he created his first dictionary. How did he call it? He took the word mila, which means word, and created a word milon, which means dictionary. He used a genius sort of understanding of language, and he knew enough, because he had been a yeshiva boy, he knew enough about the roots of the Torah and obviously with the Mishnah, and so that he could create Hebrew words. Anyways, he ended up in jail. So let me tell you what happened. It was a false accusation, and it had been instigated by a number of the older Jerusalemite Jews. Why? They were bitterly opposed to his heretical ways. A terrible thing to do. He wants children to play on the street in Hebrew. If you've ever gone, I mean, many children are playing on the street in Yiddish, right? Okay. So his jailing actually helped his work, since most segments of the younger Jewish community came to realize that his cause was just, and they rallied to his defense, in effect, aligning themselves with his effort to make Hebrew the language. It then continues to say, a critical situation. Now, I'm bringing this not only because it's fascinating and it's such a miracle to have make a language come alive, but, you know, we're going through a difficult time today with a lot of controversy and a lot of division of, you know, where the country is going. We've gone through these things before. We've had these divisions before. We've come out with, pardon? Yes. So a critical situation then developed in the 1920s. The war of the languages broke out. And here is what happens. Influential and wealthy German Jews decided to establish the school. Now, the key here is influential and wealthy. And since they are influential and wealthy, they think that they could perhaps dictate that the language will be German, because they are believers in the beautiful German, and I'm not pushing the German language away. So a number of the teachers in the new school and the early leaders of the Zionist movement then living in Palestine urged Ben Yehuda to rally a campaign against the use of German. And it became a cause célèbre, with students and teachers striking, of course. You thought striking starts, you know, here in Canada with 150,000 people striking? 150,000. So there were teacher strikes and popular petitions and influential Jewish leaders in Europe. And eventually the conflict was resolved and Hebrew won out. It's really very, very interesting, because the fight, you know, there aren't many Jews in Israel at that time, in Palestine, there really isn't. But the passion and the belief that this is the way we're going is so important that linguistic victory became the watershed that led to a growing use of Hebrew in all the schools in the country. And of course, we already know about his Milon. And he had all kinds of wonderful ideas. He worked on it for many years, maybe all of his life. And if I'm not mistaken, his wife continued, because they also needed financing for this big Milon. It wasn't just one volume. And so it says here that a number of other countries, Hebrew is offered as a full-fledged foreign language in colleges, right? And it is. There's a lot more to say. What's the focus today? One, on the miracle of the revival of a language. Two, on the fact that we as a people get passionate. We have, you know, strong opposition to whatever, but ultimately, you know, we like to think that we win at the end of it all. There's a sense that we win the best route. But I'm fascinated by the fact that he understood that the Sephardic people need to feel that they are heard, because for a long, long time, there was a lot of controversy about where that's going. So if you'd like to stay a little bit longer, I've got two or three more things. I'd like to start really with a little story. And also at the same time, tell you that in our parasha, Shabbat is discussed again and again. So I'd like to be able to share that as well. The little story is written by Rabbi Moshe Meirovitz. He was a rabbi here for a while and that said it. And he tells us that as a child, I became aware of the numbers that were tattooed on the arms of concentration camp survivors. And one summer, I spent a week in the Catskills with my aunt. My aunt was a nurse, and my uncle, he was a doctor, both of whom were also survivors. To my amazement, they had a celebrity patient. The patient was Rav Moshe Feinstein, very, very well known. Anxious to personally meet him, I sat nervously in the waiting room, awaiting his arrival. I was frozen when he arrived. Suddenly, my aunt came out of the waiting room to greet him. Rabbi Feinstein, did you meet my nephew? Can you believe a shegetz like me has a yeshiva bochel in my family? Rav Moshe looked at me. I was horrified. My aunt addressed him irreverently. She was joking with him. And then it got worse. She surely knew, as a woman, not to shake his hand. She didn't. Instead, she kissed him. She kissed him affectionately on the cheek. She then told Rav Moshe that my uncle, the doctor, would see him shortly. Well, Rav Moshe looked at me and I wanted to die. I walked over to him to apologize. Rabbi Feinstein, I am so sorry. my aunt, well, she isn't from, she doesn't understand. And he immediately placed his fingers on my lips to stop me. He then softly spoke two sentences in Yiddish that I will remember for the rest of my life. She has numbers on her arms. She is holier than me. Rav Moshe had understood what I did not. Our holiest generation is defined by the numbers on their arms. And so it's okay to do Yom HaShoah one day a year, but not quite like that, right? We continue to honor people, and we are grateful to have them with us today. I have one more thing that I'd like to share with you, and I know that the time is kind of late. And I'm going to do that because one of the things that I believe needs to happen in any gathering is to somehow remember, celebrate, and honor people who gave more than we even understand to our state of Israel and to the Jewish people. Now, remember, when I say state of Israel, I mean all of us. We walk tall and we're proud because we have our own country. And we really are one, even if we do speak English. Pardon?
And we paid a huge price for it.
And we paid a huge price and continue to pay a huge price. Just before we do that, remember that Shabbat is mentioned again and again in our parasha. And Shabbat, of course, does not depend on the calendar, right? It's the seventh day. And who of all people did I bring? I brought a man that you already heard about. His name is Thomas Cahill. What did he write? The Gifts of the Jews. And here's what he says. No ancient society before the Jews had a day of rest. In other words, the whole idea of the weekend starts with the Jews, right? And the French call it le weekend. They do. The whole idea of a weekend came from Jewish ideas, right? And so the Jewish Shabbat comes from the word what? What does it mean? To strike or to stop. Exactly. Shvita is a strike, and Shabbat means to stop. So, no ancient society before the Jews had a day of rest. The God who made the universe and rested tells us to do the same, calling us to a weekly restoration. What should we do? We should study, we should pray, we should recreate, it says. So in the Talmud, we have the beginning of what Nachum Sarna called the universal duty of continuous self-education. And Shabbat gives us that opportunity, but so does Sunday morning at 10:30. Israel being the first human society to so value education and the first to envision it as a universal pursuit and democratic for those. Now, who's writing all of that? A person who's not Jewish, Thomas Cahill, who wrote a book, The Gifts of the Jews. He's not Jewish at all. So the connection to both freedom and creativity lie just beneath the surface of the commandment, leisure. Leisure is appropriate to a free people. That's what we have. We have freedom. And so we have a weekly celebration of learning and a weekly celebration of freedom. Leisure is the necessary ground for creativity. And he says that we are free to imitate God. God rested, and so do we. Should you ever want to look at that book, it's very interesting. It's The Gift of the Jews. And it's wonderful, wonderful. Because he recognizes what the Jewish people have given to the world. The gift, Thomas Cahill, C, not K, C.A. Hill, H-I-L-L. I'm going to touch really very briefly because I only have 5 minutes and maybe shouldn't start, but I'm very excited. I actually spoke to Bev about him many times and I'm very excited about that. I'm looking at the book that the friendship, really, the friendship between Shimon Peres and a man called Al Schwimmer. And we won't have time to do a lot, but I want you to know the name. And if you're ever looking up something, it's important for us to celebrate his complete devotion and commitment to a country. And what he did for us can't really be assessed. It can't. He is the one who did so much. He had a team. In fact, Al's team could build the first aircraft for El Al. But if you go way, way back, my goodness, he did all kinds of amazing things. And I don't know that I've ever known someone as good at their craft as Al Schwimmer was. With a remarkable lack of resources, he and his team seemed capable of fixing and flying any plane in any circumstance. And I remember a time, says Shimon Peres, I remember a time when I had tried and failed to purchase 30 surplus Mustang aircraft before the U.S. military destroyed them, as was the standard in those days. But I couldn't get it. The planes had been cut in two and had their wings amputated for good measure, right? The wings were amputated. But as far as Al was concerned, Al Schwimmer and his team, this was just a minor detail. They quickly purchased the parts from a Texas junkyard and they reassembled and tested the planes. And then they disassembled them because it had to be shipped to Israel. It's just one amazing thing that he did. And in fact, he rented a very modest airplane hangar in Los Angeles, and he purchased a collection of tools, and he hired a small crew he knew he could trust, among them his fellow pilots from the war. Inside the hangar, in what looked at best like a makeshift operation, Al and his team had created an impressively agile maintenance shop for airplanes. By the way, he is the one who eventually sets up the Israel aviation industry. That's who he is. Back home, it says Al and I had many meetings. As it was expected, everybody thought this was stupid. It's a folly. The chief of the Air Force thought the idea was ludicrous. That Israel had neither the need nor the capacity to do what we described. And we met with the economists and industry experts who thought it laughable that we would ever be able to export planes to foreign markets. They were convinced that the world would look with skeptical eye on Israeli-made products. Remember, this is way back. Our only industry, they shouted, is bicycles. And you must know it recently shut down. What madness is it to think that we can build planes when we can't even build bicycles? Anyways, it does continue and is fascinating. We spoke to engineers and who were certain that Israel lacked the expertise that was needed to build and manage such a complicated operation. And I'm going to jump and tell you that Ben-Gurion pleaded with him to do it. What he offered was far more than I had expected. He not only agreed to move the project forward, but he also told me I was expected to oversee it myself, and I was already 29. Just 29 years old. He had absolutely no training. But then it says, I had come to believe, this is Shimon Peres who's saying, you need to dream big. I'd come to believe, but when you have two alternatives, then you'd better look at, you know, it just continues to talk about the decades after Al first started wielding his wrench, the Israeli aviation industry would be renamed Israel Aerospace Industries to commemorate the addition of space satellites to its product line. There's so much to say about him, but I will tell you that one of the things that we just admire is that he didn't see it. By the way, he was breaking many laws. Don't misunderstand. He was doing things that the government in the US didn't approve of at all. He decided, this is the other part I must tell you. They apparently had built some kind of airspace or whatever, a Stetoufa. So he says, you know, maybe we could become their official airline. Why not? They don't have any, so we can become. In France, where Shimon Peres was sent, they had decided that what you're getting is a picture. I turn into a pumpkin at 12 o'clock. What you're getting is a picture of how amazing it is that we have a country of amazing people, of people who don't see that we are tripping over something, people who see that these only lead to more possibilities, more efshayot, we can. That's what we read, and you have to dream big. And by 1956, Ben-Gurion already says, you know, we have to go nuclear. I just told you, they can only make bicycles. And now he's talking about nuclear. Is that right? Oh, yes, we have to. We have to. Who does he send to France? This young Shimon Peres, he doesn't speak French. He doesn't have any idea about nuclear anything. But Shimon Peres knows how to greet and be with people. I think that that was his amazing genius. Is there more to tell you? Much, much more. Much more. But the fact that Ben-Gurion invited Al Schwimmer to come to Israel and to build this aviation. Ben-Gurion says, here's just one more thing. I know it's late. So when he arrived at Al's workshop, Ben-Gurion was astonished. Al and I escorted him through the hangar and demonstrated some of the team's best work. So at one point, Al pointed out the equipment that the team used to repair and rebuild aircraft. What? Ben-Gurion says. With this tiny collection of machines, you can what? Renovate planes? Schwimmer said yes. We need something like this in Israel, says Ben-Gurion. We need to be independent. It was exactly what I had hoped to hear. I think you're right, Al says. I'm glad you think so. We'll expect you to come to Israel to build one for us. Wonderful, wonderful relationships of people who are willing and they're able to see what I had called many times purpose and possibilities. Is there more? Yes, and maybe we'll come back to that. Today, we're going to say a wonderful prayer for the Chayalim. People need to have a vision. And if we have a vision, then the impossible is to dream the impossible dream. Today, our learning has been dedicated to Rabbi Benjamin Hecht, unfortunately passed away, and we honor his memory, his scholarship, his learning, and that which he shared with so many people. And we are, and his compassion for people, and we honor his inspiration, his inspiring words. And I'd like to be able to say that we extend condolences to his loved ones, and may they be comforted among all the mourners of Zion and Jerusalem.
Is there a short answer to why you're about to get married on Lag BaOmer?
Yes. So Lag BaOmer the tradition is that the 33rd day of the counting became a break in the war with the Romans. And according to our, we're not sure if the plague was because people were not being buried. I mean, the sheer numbers is horrific. Or the 33rd day, I don't think it was the end of the war, but it was a terrible war. Do we think, I mean, I'm not talking for myself, you know, was it a mistake to even have this war? Remember that every war means that people start to disperse. They're not secure in Israel. There is no authority. It becomes, and Rabbi Akiva himself is suffering the death of a martyr. I myself, so let me just make it very clear. There are parties. I believe that in a war against Rome, I need to be in the peace party. Because I don't think a war against Rome is.
Well, if you look at Masada, I mean, they all gave up their lives because it was hopeless. But they've held up for 3 years.
Who is the major power in the world in those days? Rome. Little Judea or little Palestine is going to fight against Rome. They've already destroyed the Second Temple and now there's another war. You get my own feelings, but I'm not dictating anything. Rabbi Akiva was the authority at that time. And the Jews fought. For all those who are going to stand up and say, Mishaberach Avotenu Avraham Yitzchak V'Yaakov, ויברך את חיילי צבא ההגנה לישראל, ואנשי כוחות הביטחון העומדים על משמר ארצנו וערי אלוהינו מגבול הלבנון ועד מדבר מצרים, ומן הים הגדול עד לבוא הערבה ביבשה, באוויר ובים. ייתן אדוני את אויבינו הקמים עלינו ניגפים לפניהם, הקדוש ברוך הוא ישמור ויציל את חיילינו, מכל צרה וצוקה, מכל נגע ומחלה. וישלח ברכה והצלחה בכל מעשה ידיהם, ידבר שונאינו תחתיהם, ויתרם בכתר ישועה ובעטרת ניצחון, ויקוים בהם הכתוב, כי אדוני אלוהיכם ההולך עמכם להילחם לכם, עם אויביכם להושיע אתכם, ונאמר אמן. I want to thank all the Zoom people, I want to thank Alan, and I want to thank everyone who has joined us today. Hopefully, thank you. We'd like to invite everybody to come back next Sunday. A wonderful learning community. Kol hakavod, toda rabba, and toda rabba to Alan. And thank you. Have a great week. Thank you, Hannah.
Thank you so much
to Zoom people. I'm sorry that there isn't an image because the camera wasn't working. Thank you for coming. Have a great week.
Thank you for the great lecture.
Thank you.